the island before turning everyone on it into paste. So in that time, as per their word, they have not really engaged in any hostilities that you know of. There are or have been reports of sounds of great metal clashing, and it sound like industrial plant type noise pollution coming from the plains south of Stella Maurice. Otherwise, fairly quiet on that front. Rivers, I assume you've given them a heads up that you told Millie and Vanilli about the hollow earth.
Yeah, sure, why not?
I mean, you could just let them find out the hard way, but if you're nice enough to tell them about that, they will be on a sort of alert for anything in case, you know, the Hollow Earth is a very big place, and the chances of them finding the lighthouse don't seem too big, but you never know. And they are still going to pay attention to that, and will, of course, let you know if they see anything. They don't personally love the idea that you told them these two about the Hollow Earth, especially considering that it seems like Roy is banking on some kind of problem with Avicii and the Crowns being a key part of whatever plan it is that he has in mind. But they also understand that you might have been in a position where that was the right move for you. So, till then, they will be paying close attention and monitoring things in the Hollow Earth, which your group knows very little about, but you can be sure is quite expansive. In the meantime, Claudia, your, we'll say, egg is pretty much permanently set. The flesh egg that you basically birthed off of your body is now well hardened and has actually probably at this point taken on a metallic sheen, reminiscent of, in fact, is just coral steel. Like, it's now like a coral steel wrapped pearl. You no longer have just a flesh egg, you have one giant coral steel pearl. The internals of that pearl are going to be all the more difficult to assess with any kind of scientific tool. I was trying to get a reading through coral steel. It's not easy thing. You have to actually drill into it and do a biopsy if you want to. Otherwise, what do you plan to do with this thing? Do you just keep it safe and sound? Do you experiment with it at all? Or do you just give it over to somebody? What do you do with this thing?
I imagine she's gonna find a nice place for the lake. I imagine she thinks this is basically the equivalent of the hatching phase of after you plop out an egg. So she probably finds a nice like place to have it where it's like relatively well protected and shielded, and probably put some monitoring on it, like maybe a baby monitor kind of thing.
Okay, you set your egg up in a nice safe location with a baby monitor so you can keep track of it. It does notably, because you're so sound attuned, it does have a particular tone that comes off of it. Very consistent, just low hum. It's not like maddening or anything, it's just, it hums.
Is there a particular frequency it's having, or just like, is it a song that it's humming, or is it just a casual hum?
I would say, like, I guess go ahead and give me a, I don't know what you'd roll for this. I guess either gaze or secret sniffer. Either one is valid for this.
All right.
You aren't exactly 100% positive as to what the sound is, but if you had to describe it after hearing it and you wanted to describe it to somebody who doesn't have your level of hearing, you would say that it sounds like an atomic sunrise. There are sounds within it that are reminiscent at the same frequency as an atomic detonation or an atomic reaction, but also the same sound as like quickly warming air. It sounds like a bomb. A very, very, very strange bomb, but a bomb. You can sort of hear the energy and the reactions inside of that metal casing it has.
Okay.
It doesn't sound like it's volatile, I will say that. It has a very steady frequency. But you can hear that it does have this danger to it, I will say, or this sort of potential. For now, you're just going to leave it in the little nest, I suppose.
Yes, the little nest. Definitely shielded from everything possible.
Okay. Moving on from that, we'll get back to sort of what Claudia's been doing, but moving on from that ice peak, you have had time to turn over the watch that you have to the light tower and to Rivers. So now is the question of, do you actually hand the watch over to them, or do you find reasons to delay that?
I should probably find reasons to delay that. She doesn't want to, but...
Okay.
She should.
Notably, the watch is very much probably the most accurate watch you've ever owned. It's very good at keeping time. The spirit inside of the watch is largely quiet, save for the ticking sound that the watch makes. It is a very crisp mechanism within that just keeps time perfectly well.
I feel like she'd want to have a very honest conversation with him about why they wanted her to turn him in.
Okay. How would you have that? Like, I guess you could try to summon his ghostly cells out of the watch.
If that is possible.
All right. Using your kind of necromantic abilities to conjure holographic cells based off of dead energy and matter. You can create, we'll say, maybe not a total exercise. You couldn't totally exercise him unless that was what you were going for. But if you just want a projection to talk to, eventually in time, the floating torso of Cortland will kind of appear projected out of the watch. Just as he always looked, he is seemingly tired. He seems like he just woke up from a nap, a very, very long nap.
I guess we could be at the bus stop where I first met him.
Sure. He will pay attention to his surroundings and then kind of turn to you and look kind of questioningly at why it is that you have called him out here. Is there something the matter?
I am afraid.
Of what, precisely?
I am afraid that if I take you into that place, the other part of you will take you.
A reasonable fear. Maybe it's better to just throw me into the ocean somewhere or launch me into space. That could be safer.
How slow works, I do not think there is avoiding it.
No, there probably isn't. I've always wondered about the nature of my ability to precisely time things. Was it just a countdown, or did I make those things happen by putting them on a schedule? Part of me wonders what was inevitable and what wasn't. This sort of meeting or reunion could also be an inevitability, I suppose, but if my watch is still accurate, then it will happen when it happens.
I suppose I am simply greedy to want to delay it.
understandable, I suppose. It could be difficult, even lonely, to live the sort of existence that you and I do. And for you in particular, the things that you've gone through and the way that you exist in this world are not like anything else. For me, I would say I'm pretty unique in my own right. The clone of the Antichrist as a ghost is a bit of a strange condition. The longer that I'm here in the world of the living, the more aware I become of those things that I lost. It is fine, though. If they want to keep me locked up somewhere because they think it's safer for all of existence, then I should really have no problem with this. I am, after all, a servant of public good, like you.
And that is why I do not want to lock you up.
Sometimes it is necessary to do what is difficult. But it is still necessary to do it.
Then I shall put away my pride and ask you for forgiveness before I turn you in for multiple reasons.
There's nothing to forgive. At certain points in the history of this world, I believe police had something like qualified immunity. You couldn't be held accountable for the things that you do in the course of your duties. Otherwise, it would be difficult for you to act as law enforcement. If you have to turn me in, even though you think that I am innocent, but overall it is good for society, then you should do what is right by your station and your personal beliefs. I'll be fine. I'm sure. Life's already passed me by, so I'm not afraid of things like life sentences or even eternity.
I will put in a good word on that account for you in particular, but I am also saying sorry because I killed you.
And yet I don't really feel much like anger or sense that I need revenge. Most ghosts would, were they wronged. I feel nothing of the sort.
Then why do I feel so guilty?
I don't know. People are complicated. Clocks are simple.
You are, and always have been, a wonderful being.
It's good to hear. I'm glad at least someone thinks so. I'm sure whatever happens will be just. I have faith, I think, that the world continues to want to turn. Likewise, I do not think the flow of events would have led me to anything like complete catastrophe. Something tells me, I think, an intuition. The clock will keep turning, the hands counting time as it goes by, spinning endlessly until it resets back to the very first number on the dial. That face, immaculate, flawless, those hands moving in smooth, quartz lined motion. They keep turning. Tick, tick, tick. Talk, talk, talk. So will I. Don't worry, Doctor.
Ice Feet gently takes her hand and puts it to his ghostly face.
Though there is not true flesh there to make contact with, the electrical currents that animate the projection feel something like feedback, a haptic reaction through the skin. The ghost made of electrical signals and the alignment of strange mirror-like cells that float on air in dark shades create the illusion of a face, the illusion of a man, the ghost within that clock, within that watch, strapped at one point to your wrist and through many adventures. but the ghost within seems resigned to his fate. So will you then deliver him as Rivers has requested?
Yes, I will now open the door to the... Right before the bus comes, I will open the door to Rivers.
Okay. Going to the lighthouse for you is now a pretty simple task. The walk seems long down the corridor, and there is a sort of somber tone on the, we'll say in the lobby of the lighthouse. People are starting to come to terms with some of the things that they've seen and done since the takeover of the new director. Director Carinella has not just been trying to get the staff of Rivers to work more closely with her, but also to come to accept some of the people they've lost, some of the weird cosmic horror that they have been standing against in their time in the organization, and also some of their identities. Most notably, you hear one of the guards kind of saying to the other guard, "Did you know I was a painter at some point?" And one of the guard that he's talking to looks at him and says, "What, you?" "Yeah, right. I've seen your socks. They're not even color coordinated under the uniform." They both kind of have a laugh about that. Otherwise, when you enter, obviously there's a notification, and Dr. Carinella and a few of her personal guard are there at the front lobby to receive what it is they assume you have brought to them. She has a small black case with turning vacuum locks, a very space-age, atomic-age kind of container, about the size of a pencil case, but seemingly quite intricate. She approaches with the guard flanking her on either side, taps an incredibly long sequence of numbers into a numberless keypad atop the case. So it's a combination that she seemingly knows, she has memorized, but the amount of a string of numbers is quite long. Impressive even for a merman, honestly, to have done this, but for someone like her, it seems almost unthinkable. She opens the case and then presents it forward. "I believe you have something that we have requested, Dr. Icepeak. If you could place it within this case, it will be locked away within a sort of, we'll call it a quantum curiosity. A box which cannot be opened by anything but a certain set of actions, one that is incredibly difficult to memorize. Nothing, and I do mean nothing, will open it otherwise. You can trust me with this, of course. You know where the lighthouse is, and you know who I am. Your friend will come to no harm while he is in this container. Because of the nature of it, it will be as if time truly does not ever go forward. He will be locked in temporal status, more or less. Just a stasis, rather. It's just, it will be like going to sleep. Him.
Can you not keep him as humanely as you have the other?"
"I'm afraid it's not truly an option that we are willing to risk. If we were to try and put him into a cell, there is a more than 0% chance, I believe, that he would somehow be compromised. If anyone were to get their hands on something like him, we do not know exactly what would happen, but we do know that even allowing you to move around with him for as long as you have is a potential risk on a global level. I know it doesn't seem like it, but the amount of faith that we had in you that this wouldn't occur should now seem quite clear."
"He considers himself a public servant."
"I can see why he might. But I suggest you do not get confused here. He does not have a true personhood. I know that when you talk to him, that he has a name. And when you look at him, he has a face, eyes that you can look into, a mind that responds,
ask the question. And it seems even like he has dreams, poetic responses, philosophies. But at the heart of him, there is something not like a soul. It's different. He is a clockwork mechanism made from ethereal parts, a sort of robotic soul, you could call it. Humane would be quite generous. But in this case, I will tell you, he won't even have the conception of suffering, at least not in our care.
And what is a merman soul?
That is a question we have yet to answer. One might say that there is no merman soul, and from what I have seen in studies, that may actually be true. There's a part of me that thinks that you don't have that same sort of, how do I say it, spark, but something else, a wave, some sort of grand unified field. Strange thing it is. The idea of a soul for you is not the idea of a soul for us. It's different. Not monstrous, but an alternate path, one could say. A division that is not divided. Something more for you to look into, I think, should you be curious enough. For now, though, we will require you to surrender that watch and the ghost within it. All questions on philosophy and theology can be answered afterwards.
I feel like Icepeak would be tempted to put Flo on the watch before she put it in the box.
Put what on the watch?
Flo on the watch.
Flo electricity?
Yeah, because it is made out of metal, as long as she's very gentle with it.
If you put flow of electricity on, I mean, you can, but keep in mind, Rivers is very aware of flow. It's practically in their mission statement to know that flow exists. It's likely okay. They were aware of it before you were.
So she would know immediately when I did it?
Well, that is a good question. She might not, but that doesn't mean that no one will notice.
It would basically only be like a well wish.
A well wish?
Like a... Yes, like she's wishing him well.
Okay. Like the last hand of electrical warmth before he's put into what is seemingly an ice-cold black tomb of timelessness.
Yes.
Okay. Dr. Carinella holds the box forward. She doesn't seem to notice that you do invest any flow into it. In fact, she doesn't react at all. The guards don't notice either, for whatever it's worth. Do you place the watch in the box?
Yes.
Okay. Once the watch is in the box, Dr. Carinella closes it with one clean, crisp snap. You can hear the mechanism's arm on it, and two small vents of mist kind of emit from the side as it compresses, and there is a very brief sound of like a sort of vibration as a field activates. She holds it, but it floats above her palm as she does. She moves her palm and it follows along with her. Well, I'm sure that was very difficult for you, Doctor, but you've made the right decision. With this currently in place, Rivers will be much more effective. This sealed container is not just a prison. It's a sort of timekeeping device. We can use this quite efficiently, and we will.
While he, of course, will be locked away in a sort of timelessness that doesn't negate necessarily his existence, the aspects of him that went into his entire makeup. We can use this box to harness that. Think of it as a sort of fourth dimensional battery. In a dire time of need, we might be able to expand this to create more time whenever we might need it. Or we could probably use it to slow down or speed up certain processes, enough so that we can finally stand somewhat of a chance in case Leroy were to ever escape containment. This could be quite the potent counter agent to something that is overwhelmingly difficult to deal with. You have served reality well, and of course the world thanks you for your sacrifice. She hands the floating box over to a guard who takes it into his palm, and the small group of them begin to walk off, very carefully guarding this container. If there is anything else that you need, we at Rivers will be happy to provide you with any services, including, of course. She reaches one hand out towards you, and oddly, you find your hand reaching out towards hers. She takes your hand, and the room seems to darken a bit, though she does not. In fact, she seems to emit more light as she says, "If you need grief counseling, for example, I can provide that for you. I am still a therapist, still here to understand, to help you work through these difficult times. I'm not distant, I'm not some sort of figure that waits in a room somewhere, in an office. I'm not simply gone when you need it most. Though Rivers may be an organization very much geared towards the defense of reality against all manner of threat, true defense, true healing begins with the self, always. Leroy, he always mistook violence and evil for his form of therapy, his way to cope. I would never make the same mistake, Doctor, I speak. I never did. I never will. In her hand, your hand feels suddenly extremely small, like a child's. It's both comforting and terrifying. And the moment seems to stretch on forever until she finally releases her hand and the room's lights seem to come back up. She smiles. Make an appointment anytime you wish. I'll be here, of course. Someone tries to catch her attention, calling out for the director. She smiles and waves to them. Turns back to glance at you one last time I speak. Smiles warmly, and then goes to see what the trouble is. What is the fuss? Your hand is still your hand. Obviously, you are still Dr. Icepeak, accomplished member of the Aqua Police Force. But what was it just now? That feeling, that sensation, that seems difficult, almost impossible to explain. She is, after all, just Dr. Carinella, just a therapist, just a director here at Rivers.
I speak stares at her hand for a very long time and feels very off-put. She hasn't felt like that since she was pulled out of the ocean.
Yes, I would say it is quite reminiscent of that feeling.
And she doesn't like feeling it about a woman who just put one of her ghosts into an endless eternity.
It's a very strange thing. Do you have a moment of hesitation or self-doubt as you stand there in the lobby?
A little, yeah, yes.
Go ahead and roll me a gaze roll.
My gaze is too high, but we'll see.
You're in danger, but you don't know why right now.
Okay.
There's a feeling that creeps up on you, like the feeling of a small animal in the brush about to be leapt upon by a bird of prey or by a wolf. Something has noticed your hesitation and now has eyes on you. Something that exists within this lobby and within the lighthouse. If you look around at the guards, you cannot see what it is. You don't see anything out of the ordinary. But if you had hairs on the back of your neck, they would be very well raised.
Ooh.
A dreadful aura. Somehow familiar, but different. Something similar to something you felt before, but there is a very distinct change in whatever that is, such that it would be difficult for you to determine what the original feeling even came from, but it is something you felt before. The longer you stay in the lobby, and the more you suspect that there is something strange, that feeling will intensify.
Is it like a feeling of flow?
No.
Okay.
It's a feeling of, I can't use precise language without giving away what it is, but
okay.
I can tell you, you do not like it. At all.
Do I feel like the lighthouse is in trouble, so I should stay and help, or do I feel like I should leave as quickly as possible?
You feel like the lighthouse itself is staring at you.
Oh no, okay. I suppose I speak would consider leaving now.
Okay. Give me a speed roll. You turn and move as quickly and crisply as you feel is professional, but you do so at such a controlled pace and measure. Your reactions are quick enough that when you close the door behind you to leave the lighthouse, you hear before the door hits the knob. So before you get like on the catch, you hear a very small, quiet click. And then the door closes. With that accompanying click, something clicked before the door did. You're safe. That feeling immediately evaporates.
It's like another door was opening?
It wasn't a door.
Okay.
It was a very, very, very quiet, soft, I'll even tell you, metal click, not a door.
I feel like I'm missing something big.
Maybe, or something big missed you.
Oh, good. If I call into the lighthouse now, is there any weird reports?
If you go out to check in, nothing weird. Everything's fine.
Okay.
Everything seems perfectly fine. There's nothing that gives off the same air as when they needed to do the purge. They actually seem like they're pretty in order there. They're getting more in order now that Dr. Caronello is in charge.
All right. I'm being hunted by something outside of this world is what it feels like.
Perhaps so. Or who knows? The mermen do have extremely good senses and sensory perception. They are not gods of this world. They cannot see and feel everything. There are things that are hidden or invisible to even you. Even with your flow, even with your experience, it's difficult to make the exact assessment right away. And in dangerous circumstances, when you feel like it was best for you to move, you did. So you've moved. go ahead.
Oh, no. Well, I ask people do what she always says and keep moving back to her work.
Yes. At your job, I will say that you have a few reports waiting for you at the morgue, and these are also reports that you, Claudia, and you, Enya, have been picking up on. So these are some of the things that you two have been involved with over this week, and Mikey. I'll say Mikey was there as well doing stuff. So Claudia, go ahead. You give me a, let me good here. Give me a Hawaii 5-0 roll if you could. And Enya, I need you to give me a serve roll. Yeah, both range. Same rolls. Both of you have had missing person reports come in that are sort of odd that you guys would have to deal with them. In your case, Claudia, there have been a few missing person reports from the west side of town, where there's a few more of the affluent members of Stella Maurice. You were following up on, or we'll say that you were following up on a few of the kind of strange accounting inconsistencies that happened with the, you know, end of the dissolution of the Valentine clan. Though they are gone, there are still criminal connections and networks that were in place trying to kind of stay up with and maintain some of the lines of profitability. Some people were more greedy than others, as they felt like now that they don't have like a head to siphon money up to, maybe they could start accumulating for themselves and start up their own operation on the island. Instead, one of the public accountants for Stella Maurice in particular, who was suspected to be involved with the Valentine clan, completely vanished off of the island. Not a trace of them, no sign of their credit cards or anything being used, their passport, their any kind of identification. Their car is still in the driveway. It's like they just completely vanished into thin air. It's possible that they just managed to get off the island before there was any kind of actual investigation. But as a police officer who's been at this for so long, that doesn't really seem to be what you're looking at here. It really does seem like this person just vanished. There is a strange thing, though, that you do manage to find and turn into the I speak for forensics, which is a... the only way to describe it is on a beach about 3 miles away from his residence. There was a report of flap of skin that had a tattoo that he was known to have. It was an old shooting club that he was a part of. They all had tattoos on their arms back when they were in college. He happened to have one. A flap of skin was found with that tattoo on it. No other part of him was found, although it's likely seagulls got to it. But they didn't get to this one. Maybe they just didn't have the time to yet. Assuming you turn that into Ice Peak, which I assume you, because it is quite a forensic weird little bit there. Is there anything else you'd like to do with that case before you move on to anything else that's on your table, Claudia?
I feel like she would interview friends and family members, if this guy had it, of course, like basically form next of kin and do typical police work, like follow through before heading.
Okay, you go to interview the family of this man. We will say that he is, his name was, Richard Sonnell. There we go. Sorry, I didn't mean to type that as Enya. and his wife was named Rosalie Sanel. They have three kids. When you go to interview Mrs. Sanel and her family, her children are, two of them are adults, one is still in high school age. She actually seems pretty happy. She seems like she's perfectly fine. You can ask her, we'll say, a few questions before you feel like you're satisfied with what you learn. But what would you like to ask Miss Rosalie Sanel while you are interviewing her?
Miss Sanel, on the day in question that your husband, here, was he acting strange or anything out of the ordinary? Anything that you can remember, even the tiny little detail, someone was following him, or maybe he reported something that happened at work, anything like that?
Well, she sits down on a new couch and kind of straightens out her dress. To be honest, things weren't exactly great with me and Richard. There's a lot of people who think that I might have done it for the insurance money, but no, nothing of the sort. He was troubled, I think. There had been events that I think he had become tangled up with, and it had made him distant from his family. And so I actually saw very little of him over the past year. I was worried that he was having an affair of some kind, as would be natural, especially because he had seemed to have come into some money. But as it turned out, he had made some investments early on before the takeover of the New World Order that had paid out, and he had taken out an insurance policy that had taken care of us. So I don't know where he is, truly, but I do know that the future looks much more secure for me and my family, I think, especially with him not being here, because Lord knows Richard was a rather difficult husband and father. I hate to say it because there's a chance I might be speaking ill of the dead, but it's better without him here. I think he knew that as well.
Okay. What were these investments that paid off? If you don't mind me asking.
Yeah, he had invested in a few of the emerging news corps that had been kind of coming up in the Seven Nations. He had made some very early sort of, he got in on the ground floor of a few of them that had been expanding out sort of towards here, towards the west. Or the east, west of us. Some in Vladivostok, I believe, and a few in northern Russia. Well, the ports, of course, satellite, radio communications, that sort of thing. He had made some solid investments there. I believe it was through some contacts that he had with some trading company or an electronics firm, it was something. Import-export, I believe. They had connected him to some foreign trading and foreign investing information, and that's about when he started to become more of a ghost than the Richard that I had married. And I do mean that. He got pale and wasn't eating or sleeping properly, but I suppose he was making his money just as the only way Richard knew how, questionably. I've had people go through the bank accounts. We've done a bit of the forensic accounting to ensure that I am not on the hook for anything illegal that Richard might have done. So far, I have a clean bill of health, but if you're here for that, then you can feel free to join the efforts to comb through any of my records or his records. But I don't think you're here for that sort of thing. You are not exactly dressed like a number cruncher. No offense, I don't mean a stereotype.
No, I'm not much of a number cruncher, but if you could forward the information for the records to, please, so we can look through them, you know, have someone look through them and, you know, verify, like, this company that he invested in and, you know, but like you said, he was the ghost when he came back from that, so that's a little worrying. Makes me think that there may be some connection there between his appearance after going to work for that you know, investment. So that's one angle we're going to look through. I hope you don't mind.
Oh, not at all. To be honest, I would appreciate it if you did. And if you found anything questionable, I'd be more than willing to, of course, do my duty as a citizen to turn over any funds that might have been illegally gained. I have no interest in having even the shadow of guilt hanging over me or my family. It will all be forwarded to you, and I will have complete transparency throughout.
Thank you. If you think of anything else, you know, here's my number. Yeah, I'm sorry this happened. Even if Patsy probably isn't that sad. We're still gonna look into it a little bit. Just, you know, if you think of anything, need anything, don't hesitate.
Of course, but sorry. No. Dear, I feel as free as a bird right now. I truly do. She stands up and extends one hand towards you. If you'd like anything, tea or coffee before you go, you just need to ask. We have some very nice selections. Even though imports have gotten tight, we still keep a fine stock.
I'm good, but thank you for the offer. I'm probably just going to take this up to the office now as soon as possible. Try to get this squared away.
Of course. I won't take any more of your time, Detective.
Of course, it was a pleasure talking to you, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your evening.
I will do my very best. It is a lovely day outside. Be sure to look up at the sky while we enjoy it. Well, we can anyway. Claudia, go ahead if you want to. You have sort of supernatural understanding of sound, so you can roll a secret sniffer if you want to catch her in any lies. Humans are pretty easy to determine if they are lying, at the very least. The two, there might have been a few things that were off about the entire thing that could have distracted you, but I would say for the most part, you did not really detect much of a deception within anything that she said. Her tone of voice, the pulse of her heart, the just general her breath control, all of it spoke of someone who was not really lying or trying to mislead you.
Had a tragic accident.
Well, she doesn't know that. You didn't tell her about the skin, but that's also, you know, being a cop, you don't want to alert anyone to something you're not sure what it is.
Yeah, and also, like, she did say she didn't have anything to do with it, but, you know, still got to rule, still got to do some due diligence to make sure to rule that out.
Sure. As you are, I assume you just, you know, go to leave the house, get back in your car, that sort of thing?
Yeah.
As you leave, go to your car, you can give me a range roll, I guess. A three? Somewhere. Very, 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 very far away, extremely far away, and high, so up and distant, you hear a very faint pop sound, which is, for some reason, quite odd, but otherwise, there's nothing else that happens.
Do I know from which direction it came from?
God, no. It's so difficult for you to determine. You only know it was like up and far away. So up and then horizontally, far, diagonally, it was like a very far path. It might have even been over the water. But for you to have heard it must have meant it was either loud or there was something off about the audio quality of it, something notable. You just heard it, though, just the pop.
Do I know what kind of pop it sounded like? Do you mean like a boom pop, a gun, you know, pop, or
like anything? A very, very muffled balloon pop.
Okay.
So that is what one of the things that you get on your desk, I speak, as you're trying to throw yourself into your work, is this patch of skin and Claudia's notes on the missing individual that it might belong to. Presumably, Claudia also included some notes about she's going to do some follow-up on it. And that is one of the things that you get in. Another thing is from Enya. Enya, your work in the House of the Rising Sun and some of the recent events that have occurred have meant that you have run into quite a lot of individuals who come and go, a lot of transients that just need a place to stay for the night and then kind of will just sometimes wander off, though it's hard to leave a roof and, you know, warm free meals. Some of them do feel the need to wander. One in particular that you kind of befriended was the shaman that claimed to be Jeff Lynn. He is gone. He's not there anymore. He left kind of without telling anyone. He's just missing. Okay. Your search would probably have to start at the House of the Rising Sun, where you can ask some of the residents there. So go ahead and give me a connect roll for this. You're in pretty good with the members there. They know you. They three. There's more than a few people there who were familiar with Jeff, as he called himself. Most of them just called him... what would be a good name for a guy like that? I guess they would just call him, they called him Kite, behind his back, because it seemed like he was always just floating around in the air and only tethered to the world by a single string. And yes, he was also super high all the time. Kite, as they called him. I mean, they've seen him around. They just figured he drifted off somewhere, maybe to go get high, maybe to score something, maybe he's sleeping under a bridge. They're not sure. Though some of them do note that it's odd that he hasn't returned by now. At this point, we'll say 4 days. Anyone you ask about that is probably going to shrug. They mostly pay attention to themselves or to anyone new that comes in, but because Kite is such a frequent flyer, they kind of just take him as being part of the scenery. Okay, you go out onto the streets. You find that the streets are about the same as they've always been in this part of town. Quite rough, but getting a little bit, maybe less rough, with the Golgothan Pit appearing, with the kind of cleansing of some of the pollution in Gutter Town, and the end of infighting between samurai, and the rise of a more unified front amongst them. General street crime is actually kind of going down. Although there is a rise in petty theft, break-ins, and burglaries,
Violence has gone down quite a bit. It seems like people are more hard scrabbling to get their hands on whatever they can, especially now that imports are being heavily restricted. You start your search, I'd assume, kind of going through some of the places where you would think somebody like Kite might be. So go ahead and give me a range roll for that. Okay, Plight is a downtrodden. Go ahead and you want to just plus two that? I would say that'd be enough. Okay. Your walk through the more downtrodden parts of Stella Marie, how you're looking for Kite or any trace of him, kind of leads you on a snaking trail through some of the poverty of the city. Assuming that you stop and ask certain people if they've seen someone matching Kite's description, you do get one person eventually, a homeless person that is kind of sheltering on a corner of near a blighted building that's scheduled for demolition. This person, wrapped in blankets, looks up at you from their seated position, seated on a crate, a milk crate that they've probably taken from somewhere they shouldn't have.
You know that guy? The guy that talks, that he says he's always Jeff Lynn. You looking for him? Familiar. Yeah, we both used to dig for like coal and minerals around here together, the crew, about 15 years ago. Yeah, we were part of the early mining operations on the island, him and me. Things kind of went south, though. That's why I'm here, and that's why he's where he is, or was, anyway. If you're looking for him, I guess he went missing finally, huh? Yeah? Oh, sure. His name was Frank. Yeah. Yeah, I saw him. I mean, Frank's his last name. His full name's Wilhelm. Wilhelm Frank. He was an import from somewhere in Scandinavia. He was like, I don't know how much he'd want me to talk about it. I mean, he kind of eyes you over. You're like a cop, so... If you're looking for him, I guess you give a shit. Sure, then. I guess the easiest way to say it is... Wilhelm and I... We used to, you know, dig for coal, minerals, whatever we could find on the island. We had a whole automated setup, part of like a small crew that took government contracts. But we tried to do it real loosey-goosey, shoestring budget to try and extract as much as we could, as cheap as we could, as quick as we could. Because at a certain point here in Guam, it was a real gold rush when it came to trying to find deposits of any kind of thing resembling coral steel that could be found in the core below a lot of the surface of this place. So we had to dig deep. And we found a lot of good minerals along the way, don't get me wrong, but it was coral steel we were after. Any trace of it that we could find was a boon. Stuff's worth more than gold per pound, you know? Or more than diamonds. Or, I should say, worth more than diamonds in the 21st century before they took a nosedive. Man, they used to be worth a lot of money. Anyway, so we was looking for it. We was digging real deep. And Frank was the leader, you know. He was the main man on deck in charge of the mining operations, foreman. We also went into the ship, you know, me and him. Thought we'd make a lot of money. And then there was, it was a cave-in, a collapse. And he wasn't the same after. I wasn't either. I still got aches and pains. Just the gases that were released, some kind of pollution. It made it so I couldn't really. He kind of holds up a hand and tries to make a fist, but he watches his like fingers quake. He quickly retreats it back beneath the blanket. Because we were working private, it was hard to get any kind of government benefit for a long time. And me and him, one or two others, were the only survivors out of a crew of 25 guys. Frank always blamed himself for it, though. Is it even worth remembering? By the time we're done with this conversation, I doubt you'll ever see me again. But if you want to know, it's, you can call me Fareed. Kind of just shrugs. No, I guess while I'm getting it off my chest, it wasn't really his fault. I checked off the he kind of just gets choked up for a moment. I checked the box that said that we inspected a thing we didn't, and when that part failed, just kind of looks away for a moment and kind of wraps himself further in his blanket. And he's probably out there just kicking himself every single day of his life, and I just kind of didn't really tell him, but that, you know, he just kind of turns away from you in his blanket. Think, really? I guess that makes you nicer than most people would be in a case like this. Yeah, it would be nice. Yeah, you can tell he's starting to cry a bit. His eyes are watering up. But shakily, he takes your hand. Notably, his grip is quite weak. If you're really sure, I just told you, though. I'm basically a murderer, you know? Before I go, I should probably gather a few things, stuff I got nearby, just packed away, things, just mementos, a note I was going to give to him next time I saw him. I just didn't have the guts when I did. Do you mind if I, he kind of motions towards an alley, I just got to go grab it.
I'll do that. Of course. Just I'll be here whenever you get back. I'm gonna need some help getting to that place. I can't really walk very far, so I've mostly just been sitting here, and sometimes people bring me stuff. What are they feeding cops these days? They're offering to carry people around on their back. I gotta have some dignity, right? Maybe a wheelchair or something. He kind of rubs his arm nervously. After he takes your hand, he has a single makeshift crutch. It seems like he constructed it out of stuff he found. He uses that to get around. All right, I'll be here whenever you get back. Hey, thanks for letting me get that off my chest. Pretty light now, well, except for the bum legs and arms and everything else. You go look for Wilhelm. I'm sure he's out there somewhere. Maybe I'll even get a chance to talk to him again, tell him what really happened. All right. You go continue on your investigation, though you keep in mind the location of Fareed. Your course, based on what Fareed told you about where he had seen, because it kind of got glossed over, but he said he had seen Wilhelm going south towards an old scrap yard, which seems like a place where somebody might go to just kind of like hole up for a while if they can get away with it. Notably, at the scrapyard, there's very little security, so it seems like it would have been easy for someone to just get in. Inside of the scrapyard, you find that the cameras are really just there for show. They're not actually operational. You can tell that by flow of light, as in they're not really recording anything. So there's like very little evidence there, unfortunately, of anything having happened. You do find a small, in a sort of shelter made out of, it looks like a shipping container that was being disassembled, but then has been repurposed. You find a couch, some bags of, it looks like snacks, fast food that have been balled up, empty containers of water and soda, and a few clothes kind of piled up. Notably, if you were to pick through them, these do look like the clothes of Kite, Wilhelm, Frang, Jeff Lynn, whatever you want to call them. You go up and look at what is up there and see that there is, I mean, it's a scrapyard. There is a flapping sound once you get up noticeably, sort of near where you found that strange little encampment. There is a long metal hook that has been kind of just jutting out. Looks like it's just a twisted piece of scrap. No, it's not a bird. It sounds like a banner or something. It is, I mean, you can see it once you're up there. It's a scrap of looks like black latex. It's kind of fluttering in the wind. It kind of does, actually. It looks pretty out of place. Like, there's something about it that doesn't seem like it's normal latex or rubber or anything. It just kind of has a strange quality to it. Almost, even though it's been out here blowing in the wind, it's, for example, it still seems wet. Black, yes. I would say if you shine a bright enough light on it, you would see that it's actually the darkest shade of red possible. You just use your stand. It's basically telekinesis. Yeah, you knock it down, it hits the ground with a very wet slap sound. Notably, when you pick it up or you sift around, you notice it is in fact wet with blood. It's difficult to say. It's just you, this balloon flap, and the scrapyard in silence. No response. Yeah, I'll say something dislodges. Notably, it's one of the necklaces that he used to wear. Just kind of falls off. It looked like a little ramshackle religious talisman. Part of his shamanistic persona. Sure. I mean, you could sort of get an idea. It's really this usually ice peaks wheelhouse, but you're enough of a merman to be able to pick up on some things that would be characteristic of certain people. I think when you make the comparison between like blood, scent in the field, because you knew this guy so well, I would say it feels like a close match. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can back that up to send the ice peak. Okay. When you head back to Farid, you find a pile of blankets. The alleyway that he went down, you can easily see where it is and go down it. There is, it seems like somebody was in the middle of moving or packing things into a garbage bag, but they didn't finish. And there's a single folded paper note on the ground left behind. It has one word, and that word is sorry. Give me a connect roll. The four. A shadow passes overhead. Notably, the connection between you and the light is temporarily obscured. Very high in the sky is a shape moving. A very round, dark shape. You note that very high up, now that you've gotten to see, you watch as a body dangling from a very round shape floats up and further up into the sky. Its limbs are starting to inflate as well, but this thing, this round part, has become the head of that body. And you can recognize the clothing that it wears and the general shape of its limbs as that being of Farid. Is floating quietly higher and higher away from you. His head looks like this, just floating away. Eventually, the entire body, you watch kind of as it folds, expands into an entire shape with a string tethered to the bottom. Until it looks more like this shape. And quietly, this black balloon floats up towards the sun. Birds fly by it without bothering it one bit. Towards the clouds it goes, drifting peacefully away. Very, very high. It seems that whatever might have struck out at your friend has struck out at his friend. Both carried heavy burdens in their heart for different reasons. Both of them, it seems, have been taken by this thing. What do you report into Dr. Ice Peak?
I understand. Please bring in what you have found. Does this have connections to her, to the tattoo that was brought in by Claudia? Like, is it also, like, weird and...
Yeah.
Like, it's just a scrap, yeah.
I speak. Go ahead and give me a, give me a brain trust roll, we'll say. A 3. That's good enough to make an approximation here. The scrap of skin that you got in actually isn't normal skin. It's very elastic. More elastic than human skin should be. It seems to match the composition of the balloon scrap that you got. So either it's a remnant of or it was in the midst of that transformation.
Ice Peak would like to, we probably have records of missing people, right?
Yes.
Is there a spike upwards?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, then she's reported into both of them that there has been an increase in these, like, sand attacks, and that there is an increase in missing people, and this is likely the cause. Well, they all turn into balloons, but I can look into the missing cases and see if there is anything similar in their backgrounds. I suppose we would have to talk to their families.
Well, when I came out of interviews till now, I did hear this weird little pop in the distance. I couldn't see where it was, but it sounded like a really muffled balloon pop. So, gotta try.
Heard the death of a person.
Fuck that.
Once exceeding a certain amount of height, the balloon will pop. The balloon being once a person. Coming back down as scraps, which we are discovering.
Have there been any reports of people finding, like, balloon scraps from the ocean? Like,
well, I would say, Ice Peak, you could easily make the assessment that this stuff is edible. Wildlife would definitely get to it.
What the fuck is it making these things?
If you can gather enough of a singular person, I may be able to reform someone to tell me their story. But I do not imagine it will be gentle.
You have to get lucky and be near enough to appall to get them.
Actually, I speak with this much, you could reconstitute something like a ghost from this dead matter.
I may be able to constitute one from what I have now. If you wish to do inquiries upon the ghosts, you should return to this place before I do so. Also, it is possible we should call in our samurai if it is a demon.
Do we have Colin Yavi?
Typical protocol for this in your department says you probably want to at least ID that it is a demon before you call in your samurai.
Okay.
So you should probably...
Not just a stand user?
Yeah, you don't know what this is exactly. Could be a stand user, could be a demon, could be a something, but...
Okay.
Difficult to say.
All right. Claudia, you disconnected for a second. Did you hear what's going on?
Yeah.
Okay, do you show up at the morgue before I reconstitute this inflatable ghost?
Yeah, I will. Okay. Yeah, she will definitely pop in.
All right, I will do my best to remake the ghost. Oh, no, I had already heard the news. Yeah. Yes, correct. Everyone's there when I reconstitute this ghost.
Okay, you are able to gather, I would say, enough cells to create some kind of thing like a ghost. What you end up reconstituting is actually new for you, however. This is not quite the normal ghost or spirit. What you end up conjuring is a very pale, faded figure, something like a person, looks more like just an approximation of a figure. The features have been distorted, smoothed away, and instead it's just a figure that is very, very, very quietly laughing. Quietly just laughing and swaying back and forth.
Hello?
The figure ceases its laughter when you speak to it and looks at you with a look of pure hatred. They reach up, take hold with both hands of the middle of their head on either side, open their mouth and silently scream as they begin to tear apart their own holographic projection, just rending it down to annihilate themselves. They split themselves very cleanly until the entire holographic construct just disperses.
It seemed to dislike that I brought it back. Are the cells still there to do so?
Yeah, but they will actively resist your attempts. Also something you haven't seen happen before. You're going to have to make a contested roll against the four to get them to reconstitute.
I speak, tries for a moment. When she does not succeed, she will turn toward Anya and says, I do not believe this ghost wishes to be called. Doing so would may be against its will. Should I proceed? I find it disflavorful, disfavorable to me.
Should we do this, or like, should we wait and get like a much more recent body to do it, or like maybe a more recent one would be more willing? I don't know how this works, though.
I am unsure if it is the individual person or some sort of force beyond them that is resisting me. Does when I try to, like, the cells, do they feel normal, like, when I work with them? Do they feel like the reconstitutions of a person or something else?
They feel like they are, so you're familiar with, sort of, as a doctor, I think the signs of pain. It feels like the soul is in pain when you try to reconstitute it. That's why it resists your efforts.
So it feels like the soul just wants to be dead.
Yes.
It seems it does not wish to be brought back. It is happy where it is. I'm sure there is already many scattered about the city, if you wish to look. Perhaps with Claudia's hearing, you may hear another call.
So you two are going to go out and do some kind of work in the field to try and investigate this strange occurrence, the string of events. Okay. I would say when you now have like a list of kind of like recent missing persons and kind of have a profile to work with. Claudia, some of the information that you got from the widow, Rosalie Sonnell, does indicate that Richard made quite a few investments, as noted. He also made a lot of donations to nonprofit organizations on Guam and in Stella Maurice, including a pretty sizable donation to the Church of the Next 20th Century.
Oh no.
But it wasn't just that. He also donated to the arts foundations here in Stella Maurice, to the school system, to local museums and libraries. So it seems like, aside from what he put aside for his family, he also was making a lot of donations towards different groups, religious and kind of nonprofit, and some charities, some, you know, whatever he could throw money at.
What about the investment firm that he got, that he invested right before he went ill as a ghost?
The investment is a little bit more questionable. It's very murky, but I would say for you, because your department has personally dealt with the Valentine clan, and it's kind of in the government's, like, its scope to look into any of the remnants of that. It does look like there were some questionable shuffling around of different money, assets, names, shell companies to cover Valentine clan holdings and offshore kind of money-making schemes like investing in foreign media and radio and satellite and all that. So it kind of just seems like a way for them to funnel shift money around, and this man might have been a part of that. But it looks like he was taking a bigger cut than maybe he should have, if you judge by his financials. All of that was also just kind of laundered through local sources to remove any kind of like illegality from it, at least at face value. And any information you get back from the government of Guam would say it's like, would be kind of difficult to try and exactly pin this down as being anything but a legitimate business investment, but it smells kind of like it wasn't.
There any notable shell companies of the remnants of the Valentino clan on Guam? Or have they all moved offshore?
Most of them have been broken down into pieces and sold off. Like their various holdings and physical properties have been dismantled, with the kind of head of the organization falling apart. Some other samurai clans took over some of those areas as well and were able to kind of incorporate and basically consume them. But for the most part, the scraps of the Valentine clan have been picked over by other syndicates, organizations, and shady business interests on Guam. Hard to say if there's any that are truly still in a genetically Valentine clan at this point. The vultures have come in to prey on the corpse of the Valentine clan, as far as this is concerned.
What was the very last business he actually did then, like, before? Pop, pop, pop.
Before he vanished, the very last investment that he did, it seemed to have been a small memorial for his parents. He seemed to be investing a lot of money in that. He wanted it to be a part of a public works fountain that was going to be placed somewhere in one of the growing green areas that would have been somewhere not far away from the center of the city. It seemed like he was just going to invest in that pretty heavily, pay his money, make sure that he paid for like the sculpting, the anything that he needed to invest to secure a spot for a plaque and a few commemorative pieces for his parents, who were somewhat notable, both of them, in that they were both just kind of like scientists, kind of worked in the field of environmental protection. So he was just doing his part, it seems like. There's nothing really strange about that, I suppose, except if you were to look into his own personal history, he has not actually been in contact with them for several decades.
That is strange. I mean, if you're not in contact with your family for several decades and then suddenly go, here's a memorial, it's a little bit. But it's not in common.
Yeah, it's strange. Like, if you go through his entire forensics there, accounting wise and history wise, though he was involved in some very shady criminal organization things, it doesn't necessarily tie into the other victims, like really much at all. The mining incident that Fareed and Wilhelm Flang were involved with is actually not really related. I mean, there might have been like one or two financial bridges of buying and selling back then when they were operating between that and like what would then become eventually Valentine properties or companies, but the ties are so flimsy so as to be like inconsequential or just coincidental. As in, there is actually no tie there that seems like of substance for an investigation, I would say, by your experience as a detective.
It doesn't. Maybe we should consult with Miavi and maybe the chief asked about, like, you know, his, could be demon, it could be Sanders, it could be anything, right? But we definitely need more information. Maybe they'd have, like, a little more info, like, how, I guess, a demon would fit into this, if it was. But, like, there's nothing to go on, really. That they're preying on, they gotta be preying on something, and like so far that I'm hearing, it seems like a bit of guilt, possibly maybe just despair.
It could be the man that is donating is doing so out of guilt. I would investigate how he got his money.
Goats
do resist living.
The problem I have with that is, Mr. Snell, before he died, Mr. Snell said that he came back pale. So at some point, he went somewhere. And then, you know, he was normal one day. And then he went somewhere, invested his money or something, and came back either different or just great. Which makes me think, like, you know, maybe it's not that they're despairing and on the verge of death so much as they find this one little place, you know, and come back different or wrong somehow.
Well, if you want to consult with Miavi and Quattro, Captain, they have two different takes to provide to your team. For Miavi's part, where is his token? It's somewhere. Miavi is of the opinion. Let's get him out here. Miavi, if you give him the facts of what's happening here, first of all, he's extremely busy, obviously, because of the all that's happening on the island with the samurai, though it seems like things are starting to quiet down a bit. He would note to you, or basically in a voicemail as a return to any message that you sent, because he is like out on the streets currently. Whatever you guys in Aqua found, Yeah, this reads like a demon for sure, but there's been a lot of them recently. After that pit opened, we've seen a lot more of them flying around, so... I mean, I'm doing what I can to exercise them, but it wasn't my specialty. I was more of a duelist. Dora Lee is still on leave. I don't even know if she's coming back. I'll look into it if you want, but... I got stuff here. Duels aren't just gonna end because one guy decides that he's gonna unite everyone. There's still beef. But if you want me to focus on it, I can. It just, you know... I'll just have to cut off a few heads faster, that's all. No big for me. They're already singing my praises. That's Miyavi's voicemail. He is putting up a strong front, but he does sound kind of overworked. He's the only samurai currently on duty. Dorley is still out.
I was just going to ask, is there a way to get, like, a couple more samurai to back him up a little bit?
They're kind of all busy right now. Going on with the samurai world that's, like, kind of outside of you guys' wheelhouse. But if you talk to any of them, especially Claudia, you have contacts within what was formerly the Cure Clan in the form of the Kawasaki brothers, they're having a hard time for sure. One of them is currently a lobotomized zombie, more or less, and the other one, Jiro, is still kind of in recovery, though he has had a mechanic look at his parts and get up and running again. He would inform you that there are numerous threats that are currently approaching the island that the now formed Mr. Jr.'s group, Rhythm Nation, is currently warding them off. There have been night raids on the shores by some very strange entities that the samurai are currently working to hunt down before they get into the city or any of the cities on Guam. So they're kind of like spread out right now acting as Coast Guard, which is where he probably is. Not near Stella Maurice, but probably more on the southern side of the island along the shore. Notably, Jiro will say that... Which one was lobotomized and which one was it? Jiro or Chu? I think Chu was the one who was lobotomized. He wasn't lobotomized, but he was zombified. Jiro also makes sure to tell you that these are not demons that they're dealing with. They don't know what they are, but they seem to be some kind of like weird mutant thing. Not merman either. There are just like things kind of coming up out of the water. Some of them are getting airdropped in.
Oh, Jesus, that's... Oh, boy. When it rains, it pours.
Yeah. They're dealing with that, though. For when you contact Quattro Summits, if you give him the information and... I mean, he is also... busy, but not too busy to have a conversation, unlike my Miyavi. Quattro is, first of all, he will look over the forensic evidence given to him by Ice Peak. He'll look over some of the reports given to him by you, Enya, and you, Claudia. His conclusion is as follows. Also delivered in a voice message, though you can reach him if you want further detail. What I'm looking at here. Yes, a demon perhaps, but there is something not right about this one. But typically, I think a demon would get something out of whatever it is that they're doing, the consumption of human emotion. This one might be consuming the guilt of those that it targets, but it's a very strange thing to just create these beacons in the sky for a demon. They don't tend to want to advertise their presence. The fact that you've even seen these remnants is a bit disturbing to me. It's like a shrike, type of bird that leaves its prey, just impaled on a thorn so they can come back and get it later. I wonder if it's a similar thing, but that might be giving it too much credit. I would say you are dealing with a serial killer regardless. The connections seem to fit a profile as most demons do. But there is this strange sort of human element to these cases, I think. I wonder, is it really just the demon that you're dealing with or something else? If you want, I can join you in the field to investigate this, as I have to admit my curiosity is piqued, but I also have the feeling that whatever it is can be quite dangerous to someone like me. If it preys on guilt, I'm a fresh meal as any could ever find, unfortunately. Not to say that I'm scared or anything. Very good. Well, I am not afraid, of course, of this thing, facing it, whatever it is. I have a feeling that it will be something... Something tells me that it won't be quite what I would expect. Of course. And while I have the ear of your squad, Detective Icepeak, I've heard you've done good work for Rivers lately. The director called and was lowing about something that you had accomplished. The turning in of some contraband? Or some relic of some kind? She was practically buzzing. So, whatever you did, good job. Perhaps it might see some sort of promotion or deeper level of trust between the organization and your squad.
I would prefer not to praise for it. I did a duty.
Of course. We all do a sort of duty, I suppose. Every now and again, we have to fulfill a certain social contract with the very society that we live in. So it is a necessary thing, and I understand not always simple or easy, but good work, regardless.
May I ask a strange question?
Is there anything other than strange questions in the world today?
Not often. Do you ever feel watched in the lighthouse?
Oh yes, all the time. I am a very strange-looking individual.
Not by the people there.
Are you referring to security systems, surveillance? They have been increased.
By the lighthouse itself?
That's not something I know about. Well, if there's anything else that you'd like to know, you feel free to ask, but otherwise, happy hunting with your serial killer or demon. Do call for backup if you need it, of course. Well, that'll be all for now for me. I do have work to attend to. I will see you at the office whenever you decide to swing by. Of course. He hangs up.
Okay. What do you mean? Oh, that is, I suppose, just a strange instinct of mine. I do not know if he knows of it or just and would not like to talk of it or does not know of it. They wish to take custody of one of my ghosts. Of course. It was not my choice to make. I appreciate your point of view.
So, as you are working on this case, all of you, with some Mikey's also providing some help and info, intel where he can. Let's just give him a roll just to see how he does. Super useful, actually. Now that he's been made aware of the balloon phenomena, he's spotted at least, we'll say, 6 balloons.
That's a lot.
Currently floating in the sky at altitudes very, very high up. They have not popped, but they are up there. He's been on the rooftop keeping an eye out and marking down the coordinates of any that he sees and passing that information on to your team. He is. It's way beyond his range, man. He'd have to fly up and then use flow of wind to try and push them around. Kind of a difficult task because he doesn't even know what triggers the attacks. It's a long day, though, and by the end of it, you've compiled a list of many more people that have disappeared, some of which maybe you could try to attribute to this phenomena, some of which are still kind of mysterious missing persons. The day is beginning to draw to a close, we'll say, towards the end of it. And there are other things in the city that require the attention of all three of you. For you, Claudia, it's your family. So returning home after a hard day's work of investigations and opening, it seems like just so many new cases about this black balloon phenomena. Very stressful for you. So stressful that you can feel that egg that you nestled, you can feel it humming, even though you're very far away from it. You can feel its vibrations. It seems it reacts when you are under any sort of stress or a heavy amount. In a hum or vibration only you can really pick up on.
I guess. Time to just chill out then, because yeah, probably extremely stressful.
Well, you could say Pearl is often created from the distress or irritation within the oyster. And likewise, it seems that irritation has influence on the formation of this pearl and its development. For you, Enya, there are different duties that you're kind of responsible for at the House of the Rising Sun, but you have a little bit of additional help to try and get you through some of the stress of it. A quiet worker who is providing some labor for your like cleaning up, carrying around boxes. A man, very skinny man in a white hoodie and a mostly covered face with a like a medical mask on, is doing some work. Notably, he is quite familiar. He doesn't say much to you. He just seems to quietly work for your efforts. You recognize him even without his giant suit of armor on. Trace is doing a little bit of volunteer work quietly without note or any hope of reward or notice. If you try to talk to him later or spend any time talking to him, he will, of course, make friendly conversation with you. But he seems to just want to focus on helping out your efforts here and not talking too much about what he and the others are doing out on the sunken tower remnant that they currently are occupying. He wants to just keep the conversation a little light. But still, he is there, and he seems to care about what you're doing here. And as for... Yeah, go ahead. All right. He kind of gives a very weak laugh, but says,
"You're gonna blow my cover. We do always do our best work when we're in disguise, right?" Not a thing. Heard it went missing. We've been keeping eyes out on the waters. Something that big can't go invisible for too long. I never thought I'd see the day when it moved like this. We just gotta hope it didn't sink, right? That's all there is to it.
He will put an arm around your shoulders as if to support you.
I guess there's been a lot of stress on the job lately. I hear you on that. At least we got each other. Trying to liquor me up. Fine. But I'm getting at least mid-shelf, whatever it is, and I want it to be a Bloody Mary.
He seems to be happy with the thought and goes back to just... He's picking up and just, like, moving very heavy boxes. Like, it's really nothing. Even without his armor form on, he has a great amount of physical strength, so... He's doing a lot of the labor that some of your human volunteers would probably be struggling with. Or that you'd have to personally do. Good. That's your spirit feels lighter. Claudia, you feel like you need to de-stress. Ice Peak. Would you say a midnight stroll feels like something you might do?
Yeah, sure, why not? I feel like she's putting a lot into work right now, but, like, she might be looking for, like, street scraps. Right. Like, she can't sleep, so time to look for more bloody balloon scraps.
As you're going on your hunt, you hear something very faint.
Okay, what am I looking for? Oh no, yeah?
It's coming from a direction.
Which direction?
It seems to be eastbound.
I follow it, I guess.
As you get closer, as you are moving, the sound is getting a little louder. Until you realize the path that you're on is towards the bus station where you last saw Cortland or spoke to him and let him know of what was going to happen.
Okay.
And there is a figure there in the darkness holding a watch. A very loud one.
Does it look familiar?
The watch? Or the figure?
Both, I guess.
The figure is shaded. The watch, it looks like a very nice timepiece. But it's not the same. They just let it spin around on the chain, and it seems like their back is turned to you.
I speak will silently approach.
The ticking stops as the figure closes the watch clasp over it and pulls it into one of their sleeves. They glance over their shoulder. You only see kind of the silhouette of a face.
What is this I see? Someone who's come to me. Hello. I think I know you. Do you know me?
The figure peers over their shoulder at you, I speak. You notice that they have one visible eye with a very white, it's just a very light white color to it. Very odd, almost inhuman, like not unlike something you'd see on a merman.
I don't believe we have met.
No, I don't think that we have. I don't think we have at all. But I saw you earlier at this very spot.
You did something bad, right? Something that hurts. Something like...
The figure seems to pause and relish the moment for a moment. Just
something like you wish you could take it back. Isn't that right? Something you wish you hadn't done.
Life is full of those.
You're right about that. It really is. And the worst part is, there really isn't any going back. At the church of the next 20th century, there was a preacher who stood up at the podium. He liked to talk about just rewinding time, going back and fixing everything, undoing all your mistakes. I thought that sounded really nice, but I don't think that that makes any sense. I mean, what's to stop you from making more or different mistakes? That seems ridiculous to me. That guy sounded crazy. But there were a lot of people there that were just fired up. They listened to the whole thing. They loved what he was saying. Me? I just thought, you guys barking up the wrong tree. It's really easier to just find a way to forgive yourself, I think. You should try that. Forgiving yourself, I mean. I don't know what you did or why you did it, but you should try just being okay with who you are. Have you considered it?
I have tried.
And it doesn't work. Yeah, that's familiar.
The figure shoulders off their coat to reveal bare torso, and then turns around to face you under the moonlight.
What if you could just make all your problems just fly away?
He kind of sways very gently, and you notice that there are, on the tips of his hair, small black rings that are orbiting. Some of them detach from his braids and float around him very gently.
It would be easier, wouldn't it? Just letting go.
He puts his hand to his lips and blows a kiss at you. Those black rings that are floating around him start drifting into your direction.
This is a mercy.
Can I take out my coral steel sword and try to cut them?
You can. Go ahead and give me a speed roll. The four. You manage to cut through each that are approaching. Once the coral steel goes through them, you notice they just kind of harmlessly puff and disperse, kind of deflate and fall to the ground as small black shreds. But you also notice that the man that you were speaking to before is already walking away from you. He's just turned and started walking. He has his coat in his hand, like over his arm. His hair is still floating around, almost like it's snakes or animated in that way.
I speak would attempt to follow him.
When you do, your foot actually causes you to stumble. Because it's currently twice as big as it normally is.
Oh no.
And that spread, that inflation is spreading up your ankle. You can feel it going through each of your heels. You have a very limited amount of time here.
Can I surgery the part that's infected away from me, or just
amputate it off?
Well, basically with my molecular control.
Sure. You amputate it right off, sending it flying into the night sky. Once it's detached from you, it just completely folds in on itself and turns into,
I feel like each eel.
This part. it turns into, we'll say several of those. The man who was walking away stops and looks over his shoulder again.
You have a problem with accepting the burden of guilt. I can tell. Don't worry.
He waits, kisses his finger, and raises it to the sky. Nods his head a little back and forth.
Perhaps I prefer the struggle.
Why bother? It's already over.
I speak from behind. You can feel several of those rings just start going into your body.
Oh no!
When they make contact, it feels like cold drops of water. There's about five of them that just kind of pelt you from behind. They just were floating very quietly, according to the flow of wind. You can already feel the transformation happening in your cells, the elasticity that's increasing. You can use your molecular control to try and clamp down on it, but it's almost like it's attacking you on a, like at the core of your being. As in, your body's defenses can really only delay this.
I guess the only, like, I suppose the one last thing I could do is get a message to the others.
Sure. What would you like to send to them?
But this man's look and his location, I suppose.
You try to shoot up. Well, how do you shoot off a message? Like,
I believe that, does Rust still have my, like, an eel of mine?
He does.
I would give him as much information as possible, like a glut of information about him before that eel turns into a balloon as well.
Yeah, Russ is like currently has his headphones on. He hears this like very loud chatter, pulls them back, looks over at the jar that you're in, and sees like basically a balloon screaming at him with a mouth. And is immediately startled. Ah! What? He starts freaking out. He puts the jar under his arm, wipes his hand over the screen to turn it black, and then just jumps into it like he's diving through a window. he just enters the dark web immediately. He doesn't know what's going on. He thinks he's under attack.
Did he take the jar or did he not take the jar?
Oh, he took the jar.
Okay.
As for the rest of you, however, you can slowly feel a very strange sensation. Because he caught you off guard and you're not yet aware of what is happening, it's a little bit difficult to combat this at the moment. Instead, you feel like you feel a sense of relief. As the burden of what you had done feels like it's being lifted from you. You realize in some small part that it really wasn't something in your control. It really wasn't your fault. A lot has been asked of you. And there are forces in this world that will just make things worse. Some will make things better. You're just one moving part of many moving parts, many gears turning, many mechanisms at play, many pieces of this thing called the flow. And the higher that you are beginning to lift into the air, the easier it feels to accept that thing, that it is just fine. You can try to fight back against that sensation if you want, but it's very, very nice. Euphoric, I would say. You feel like high, even. The more that you let this sensation into your mind, the easier it is to breathe, the easier it is to just feel okay. The figure who struck you looks back once to sight your balloon floating away, gives a very small salute, and then turns around a corner to disappear into the darkness. The higher you go, Ice Peak, the more you see you are in good company. Though you have, at this point, no longer the eyes with which to see, you can feel the presence of other balloons floating around you, amongst the clouds, in the clear sky, crisp air above Guam, so tropical. Floating up there feels free and easy. This is a sort of rapture, a freeing of the soul from the flesh. And it could not be more spectacular than this. But there is some small part of you that revolts, that tries to fight against that idea. Within this balloon made of your flesh are two scraps of coral steel. One of them is yours. Another is a foreign piece of coral steel left within you from a time when you fought side by side with your sister. The smallest shard of super hot metal Once it makes contact with a shard of electrified metal within you, this creates a reaction, enough that if you can spark it, might free you from this state, although quite painfully. You can choose to fight back against the rapture and the joy of release, or you can let yourself float away into the clouds, never to think again. Which do you prefer, Icepeak?
Her duty to this world is not finished. It must be nicer for her sister.
Okay. In that case, I am going to need a roll from you. As the pieces of coral steel begin to tumble into one another, give me a clash.
So roll three things.
Roll three things. He got a zero of did I not roll a third thing for him? Well, you win on the first flash.
Okay.
You win on the he wins on the second clash. No, you win on the second clash.
I need it on the third.
Yes, you lose on the third. So as you're trying to rebel against this feeling of imprisonment, of release, of just freedom, you find that there is a voice within you telling you to just let go. The influence of a stand. Black balloons is still present inside of you, laughing from the elasticity of your cells. It seems to be woven into your very being, telling you to give up and give in. But that fire, that electrified torch of revolution and enforcing the law, allows you to ignite the internal gases of the balloon and shred it before the transformation is complete. For a human, there would be no surviving this. Even if they were able to get the willpower to fight back and puncture themselves or explode themselves like this, it would be over for them. For a merman, and especially a swarm, the resulting spray of ice peak flaps that occur is more like an angry, controlled, buzzing cloud, momentarily left suspended in air by pure force. You are reconstituted temporarily as a misty silhouette of yourself, only as your blood, like a red phantom.
Oh man. Hell yeah.
And yes, you want a lightning strike back to the ground?
Yeah, maybe. Can you stop that with me?
Yes. You turn yourself, like, you basically are able to conduct your electricity in these clouds, do yourself, including the static charge of those balloon scraps, to create basically a temporary, almost railgun that you can fire yourself down.
Hell yeah, yeah, yes.
So as he's walking away down an alley, this man, like, seems like he's pondering his next move when he hears a very bright, very loud flash go off. He looks backwards and up where he thinks the cloud should be. And he narrows his eyes. What the fuck? As he says that, the bolt actually comes down right towards his head. I'll let you decide what. How are you charging in, flying in on him, basically?
I would assume straight from because electricity has to travel to the ground, straight down.
Are you flying as like a kick, a punch? Like, are you just elbow dropping him? What are you doing from midair, basically, as this blood silhouette with lightning coming through you?
I grabbed upon like the last vestiges of Coral Steel, right?
Yeah.
So I guess I'm using that as a knife or like a sword.
Okay, you use the Coral Steel as a sword. Come down. You basically almost bisect him. Enough that he sprays blood as he starts to stumble and fly backwards away from you. He falls into a pile of trash and is just a bloody mess, basically. Like, he just collapses right into it. There is very little movement coming from him after you do this maneuver. He is not really... doesn't seem to be up. It will probably take a moment for you to reconstitute yourself, even though you just like did this tremendous strike against him. You're basically just blood and like scraps of flesh.
Yeah, I was pretty much made of electricity, so there's not much left after the strike.
Right. Yeah, burning through it. The only scrap that's left, you come to consciousness. The only one part of you that's still alive, in the rubber band sort of effect of being dragged through basically reality into the dark web. You wake up in a very cold place with a space heater nearby, and it looks like a small rudimentary tent has been erected. Rust is in the tent, currently with several plugs stuck directly into his head. Come on, give me a signal. Give me a signal, please. I have to tell somebody. I speak's in danger.
My steely balloon.
He looks back at the jar. You are not a balloon. You're kind of just you look like a deflated eel. But you're alive. Rust grabs the jar. I speak. You're alive, I think. Kind of puts his eye right up to the... Not only does he put his eye right up to the jar, you can actually see it pressing and flattening against the jar.
I think I do, yes.
Yes.
Yes, I believe I am in the land of the living, unfortunately.
Yeah, that is... I feel that way when I wake up, too. I don't know what got you out there, but it looks like you just survived by the skin of your teeth.
This is the last of me.
And what about the rest of you?
Shredded. I encountered the demons. I have wounded it, but I do not know if I have killed it.
On that note, in that alley, the figure that you sent flying and spraying blood into the garbage pile grabs one side of the pile and then another and starts to pull themselves up. Their head is incredibly disfigured.
Guilty. Guilty. Guilty.
He begins to turn the flesh of his head and the bone of his skull with black phantasmal fingers that extend from his hair, his braids. Until his head looks like this now. Figure stands up, their body becoming disfigured and spikes emerging from their shoulders and neck along their arms.
Oh, he was human, now he's demon. Great.
He starts to walk very slowly,
into the night, sees somebody crying into a bottle in a brown bag. They turn to look at him. He points at their eye and flicks a ring into their head. And then he waits patiently as they slowly transform. He takes hold of their ankle once they begin to float up. And along with the balloon, he ascends until they are but a string in his hand as he flies away on one of these skull balloons, leaving the scene quietly drifting away. And that is where we are going to call it for the night. You have encountered the the root cause of these attacks. You have followed up on a few things, and now it's just a matter of dealing with the guy. Super easy, no problem.
Really?
Easy breezy.
Uh-huh.
Cover balloon?
Yeah, balloons.
You like a birthday party.
Mm-hmm. It's fine, he's okay.
Yeah, take a nice deep breath.
The big bang happened when the black balloon ignited. I feel the pain shoulder to shoulder as I was knighted. The night turns to day and my days don't seem the brightest. It's like itis. I want to take a bite of what life is. If the president fuck around and piss off ISIS.
So there we go. That's the sort of introduction to dealing with black balloons. IcePeak has now some ID on the original user. What he is now is obviously different.
I did not realize he was not a demon already.
I had a buddy who's to stand in his use.
Well, I think it just happened. I think that's what happens now, currently. I destroyed the stand user to make a demon.